morning, sunrise service at 7:30, and breakfast following, so you will not want to miss that. Brother Lance will be preaching our sunrise service this year, and I'm looking forward to hearing you and seeing what God will have us to hear. We have our worship service at 10:30. I pray that you'll come. I pray that our church will be full, and that each one will come and have a just expect a great time. I'm going to ask something from you. I don't know if they might be, Jim could probably help me, if you would, if you have a prayer request for Sunday morning, because hopefully we will have a full house, a lot of folks that will be here perhaps will be at church, want to keep the service going in a pre-ordered fashion. So if you have a prayer request, write it out before the service and give it to me or to Joe or to Paul, and we will go over that prayer request. But I probably will not take prayer requests from the floor, just to give a little more time for the worship and praise and preaching. Okay, Brother Jim, yes.
The request will be in the bulletins.
Okay. All right. And so if they can write those out before the service starts, I would appreciate it. Okay. All right. No other announcements. Let's sing again. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we have felt your presence throughout the day. Lord, we feel your presence now. Heavenly Father, I ask that you come and touch each and every heart. Father, as we come together for communion, and Lord, that we will give you the glory and praise that is due only unto you. I pray, Father, that everything in this service will be done according to your divine and holy will. We thank you, Father, for each one that has come. Lord, for those that perhaps planned to come and could not get here, we ask, Lord, that you just visit with them and hold them close to thy heart, Lord. Father, may our time together, may as we worship and praise you, Father, I pray that we'll be drawn closer to you, of course, closer one to another. And Father, for these things that we ask and pray for, we'll be careful to give you thanks and praise. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. All right. Let's remain standing for our first hymn. And so, Brother Mike, sure appreciate your comments. God bless you. And let's sing unto the Lord.
Thank you, Mike.
Page 190. 190. Are you washed in the blood?
Are you washed?
New Testament, our new covenant, and my blood, which is shed for you. Heavenly Father, we pray that you bless the reading and the hearing and now the preaching of thy word. Holy Spirit, draw near to us and surround us. And help us, Lord, to hear what you would say to us tonight. And we'll give you the thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you notice, it was verse 15. With great desire, it is said, in one of the translations, it said, with great anticipation. Another translation says, I have eagerly looked and desired to have this time with you. And as we notice, it says, I desired to have this time with you before I suffered. Jesus knew what was ahead of him. There were no surprises. Others would be surprised, but there were no surprises in the mind of Jesus. He knew exactly what was coming down and when it would happen. But even before all those moments of chaos and all of the suffering, he says, I've chosen this time to spend with you. With that, those 12 that he had walked with, that he had talked to, he had ministered to, he had taught them over and over and over. He had also shared with them the experience of evangelism and reaching out. Even through them, there were miracles that had been performed. He had been their mentor. He had tried to be their example. He had tried to put into them what he wanted them to put into others. And yet he says, for us, I've wanted to spend this time with you. And, you know, I'm not being critical, I'm not being judgmental. But when I think of that, and I think if he wanted to spend that time with him, how much or how often would they long to have that opportunity once again to spend that time, that private time, that serene time with him? Speaks to my heart that he still desires to spend this time with us.
Amen.
And it's a little bit difficult for me to understand why some take it so lightly and not to take advantage of the moments that we can spend in private and in a special time of communion in his fellowship. I realize we can worship at home and we have daily communion with him. But there's something about coming together that when we do, that it gives glory to his name. So again, I'm glad that you come. I'm not speaking ill or wrong of anyone who did not come. We don't understand their circumstances, but I call it a privilege for my heart and my heart to be here tonight, to be with you, and to be under his anointing. There's actually four things that I would like for us to consider before we come to the altar and we stand together with our brothers and sisters in Christ, knowing that Christ is here, and although he's not physically here as he was on that evening that he took communion with his disciples, but he is here in spirit. He is truly here. He's alive. He's well.
Amen.
He's in our hearts. He's in our presence. And so therefore we should have the same sense of reverence and delight and joy as they had when he was with them. But first of all, when we come together, this is a time that we spend with a humble heart and humility. It's in humility that we should take of the bread and of the cup. Humility, because as we take of that bread, as we take of the cup, this is our testimony. This is saying from our heart. We may not say so with our lips. It may be difficult for others, for some, to testify and to witness and to give testimonies and the praises. But when you take of that bread and you take of that cup, from your heart, you're saying, I have confessed my sins to the Lord. You're saying from your heart, I have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. I have received him into my heart, and I am confessing him as my Savior. Aren't you thankful that the Lord made it so easy for us
Those who would be shy or timid or perhaps a loss of words, he can say, you can still glorify me. You can still confess me. You can still honor me when you take of the bread and the cup of suffering. Amen. So as we do so, again, it's with humility to know that it's through him, through Jesus Christ, that we are saved. It is through him that we live and move and have our being. It is through him that we have this opportunity to come before his Father's throne to worship and glorify him. Amen. Secondly, the thing that we need to remember is that a time that not only that we confess ourselves as sinners or and confess Jesus as our Savior, but it's a time that we should come with deep gratitude and thankfulness. Gratitude and thankfulness. Because as we take up the cup and as we take up the bread, we realize that we're doing so in remembrance of him. Remembering of how that he suffered. He suffered. He was a man that was acquainted with grief and shame. Through the 3.5 years of his ministry, people tried to humiliate him and deny him. There were times that the Sadducees and the chief rulers would attempt to take his life, but the hour was not yet come. He was acquainted with suffering and shame, but he went to the cross. Before he went to the cross, he was judged guilty of crimes that he did not commit. He was betrayed. He was denied. He was beaten without mercy until with many men, the beating that he took would have taken their lives. He stood, and yet, like a lamb before slaughter, he opened not his mouth. He did all of that because he loved us. And then he went on to the cross. And perhaps the best way we can understand the cross is if we can't understand that it was through his blood that paid for the sins of the world, from the sins of Adam right on through our time and the time to come. But if we can't understand any of that, if we could just understand that he went there to that cross in my place, in each of our places. Every stripe that was laid on his back, that was for me and you.
Amen.
When he hung there in shame and in suffering, it was in our place. I love this song, and sometimes I wish we'd sing it a little more often. I should have been crucified. And all of that is so true. And so when we take up the bread, take the cup, we're doing so in remembrance of him, not only of his kindness and his good life, his perfect life, but his suffering. His suffering. And then thirdly, as we come to the Lord, as we come to the King's table, when we come to the King's table, it's also another opportunity for us to examine our hearts. To examine our hearts. Not worrying about what somebody else might think or say, but being concerned with what is in our heart. What is in our heart and what God alone perhaps sees. And understands. We, as Paul wrote, he says, let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. And if we're to examine ourselves, we should expect to find perfection. But we shouldn't find anything that stands between us and God.
Amen.
No idols. No priorities. We should not find anything that's between us and God. We know that we're born of God when we love one another. And sometimes we can sort of get sloppy in our Christian experience. And sometimes we can take on the attitude of the world. And if we're not careful, we'll be acting no differently than they do. Again, examine your heart as I examine mine. Don't look for perfection, for you and I fail. We commit human error. But when we do, we ask the Lord to forgive us of that. But the main thing is, how is my attitude? Is my heart clean? Have I asked Jesus Christ not only to forgive me of my sin, but to cleanse me from all unrighteousness?
Amen.
Anything that would not be right with Him. Perhaps it's the way that I'm living. Is it bringing a tarnish or a shield over my witness? That my witness is losing impact and power because I've gotten sloppy with the way that I'm serving the Lord. I forget exactly how that Reverend Lane Loman, it just came to me. He said sometimes, if y'all remember when Reverend Lane was here for revival, what did he say? You just become dull. I didn't say it correctly. Dull, D-U-L-L, dull. And sometimes we need to examine our hearts to just see, have I become dull? Now, one of my best friends, one of my mentors, his name was Harry Dull, but he was anything but dull. He was alive. He was on fire for the Lord. He loved people. He loved the Lord. But have we become a little dull with our love? Have we become a little mechanical? Or just sometimes, you know, we've learned the language. We know the ropes. Have we come to the place of, well, can I do this and still be a Christian? Or if I do that, where are we on that line? You know, my heart, I said it a few weeks ago. We know that the world out there is among the lost, is vicious. And as a country, and as a people, as Christians, we don't know exactly what all is out there as far as what might come. But we know that it's a vicious world. And as we look at things happening, and the sequence, and how quickly these things are happening, we realize that the coming of the Lord must be near.
Amen.
And I said to us, although these things I see, those things do not worry me nearly as much as what I see in the church.
Amen.
And this is not to say that I'm setting myself up to judge or to point out situations. I'm just saying we need to examine our hearts, each of us.
Yes.
And if we become lukewarm, we need to ask the Lord to fire us up. Mm-hmm. If we become rebellious against Him, we need to ask Him to change our attitude. Mm-hmm. If we become sloppy, we need to ask Him to clean up our act. And so now that we've said all of that, we've got one more thing to say. Fourthly, as we come to the King's table, there should be, it's not a funeral service. It's somber. It should be reverent. But it's not a funeral. We should come rejoicing in our heart, because of His soon return. We find in 1 Corinthians 11:26, as Paul was instructing the people, the church, to take communion, he says, "For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till He come."
Yeah.
Hallelujah, He died, but we're gonna praise Him and worship Him Sunday because He resurrected and then He ascended. But that's not the end of the story. He is coming back.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
so we don't come to the Lord's table in defeat, but in victory that he's coming back. And he's coming back for his church.
Amen.
And he wants us to find us without, or without blemish and without spot. That he will come for us as a groom comes for his bride. And he's excited about coming and receiving us unto himself. That this should not be something that causes us sorrow, but gladness.
Amen.
I can remember the time that I stood like this and I watched Myra and her dad walk down the aisle, and I couldn't hardly wait till she got down there at the altar. And I think Jesus, he's excited about when the trump of God shall sound, and suddenly his people, his children, his bride is going to be lifted up, and we're going to meet him in the clouds, and then we're going to meet one another in the clouds and meet him in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. That's exciting, church.
Yes, amen. Amen.
And you know what? They cannot change that constitution. It's written in red. It's eternal.
Amen.
It's eternal. It cannot be changed. There will be no votes taken for it. It is the way it is, and that's the way it's going to be. Hallelujah. You know, so as we come, yes, we will come with the confessing that Jesus died for us. We're confessing that he is our Savior. We're doing so in thankfulness. Because we couldn't do it for ourselves. No one else could do it. Only the Son of God.
Amen.
And then, yes, take the moments. Now, you know, if I say, let's take a moment and examine our heart. I've been examining my heart all day. Now, you don't have to spend that, maybe you don't have to spend that much time. But, you know, it can be quite simple and easy. Just, Lord, if there's anything in my heart that you're not pleased with, you take care. We've been too many times trying to take care of it ourselves.
Right.
We cannot do it. But he can.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. And then with anticipation. We've been waiting on him. But he's come. Amen.
Yes.
So that's the message. This time, Many of you know